My name is Kent. I'm the creative specialist on the Google Web Designer team, and I'd like to show you how to get started with Google Web Designer. When you open the app, you'll see this welcome screen, and the two main choices are Create New File and Open Template. In this case, I'll make a new file. On this screen, you'll see Add Banner selected by default, but you have these other choices. I'm going to enter a file name and leave everything else as is, but quickly run through the other choices. I have my location set to desktop, and that can be changed here. You can change the environment. Sometimes I'm using Google Ads. You can change the size, make it responsive, and change the animation mode between quick and advanced. When you're ready, click OK. Now I'd like to talk about the panels. You can rearrange these any way you'd like. For example, move a panel group or dock it to the other side. You can change the order of the tabs within a group or create new groups. You can click a panel header to collapse or expand a group. Hover over the bottom of a panel group until you see this double arrow icon. Then you can click and drag to adjust the panel group height, or double click to maximize the group height. I'm going to import some assets to get started, and usually I just do it by drag and drop. Even if I delete them now, I still see those files in my library. And I can also drag straight to the library or use File, Import Assets from the main menu. The first image I want is the guide, which I'll drag to my stage. And with the selection tool active, use my tool options to align the container and top and left. I find using a guide is the quickest way to work. Then I just create elements one by one and position them visually. Next, I'll start creating elements, which will be a little easier if I change my timeline to the advanced mode. This icon allows me to toggle between quick and advanced, and we saw those options in the Create New File dialog. Now I'll drag my logo to the stage, and we see logo in the timeline. I'll use the selection tool to move my logo to the approximate top left position. Then in the Properties panel, which is the one I use the most, I'll click the chain icon to lock the aspect ratio as I scale up and down. Then I click into the width or height fields, then I can use my arrow keys to dial the logo into the correct size. Next, I want to do the same thing with my product photo. Now these images I've created at the full final size, which is often the best practice as it results in the smallest file size. If you're designing for mobile, you may want to save your images that double the final size so they look sharpest on a Retina screen. So I have my product and logo images done. The next thing I need is the typography, so I'll switch to the text tool. This is a good time to mention the tools in general. I mostly just use three tools: selection, element, and text. Each time you change the tool, you'll see a different set of controls up here in the tool options bar. For example, the element tool, also known as the tag tool, has the modifiers div, image, video, and custom, which allows you to type any tag. I usually leave it set to div. With the text tool selected, you'll see options that are also available in the text panel, and I'll just make sure its modifier is set to paragraph. And we've already seen the alignment controls available when the selection tool is active. So with the text tool selected, I'll draw a text box for Google Home Bundle. I use Command A to select all these characters and change the color to #888. And with my selection still active, I'll change the font to the Google font Poppins. I don't see Poppins in this list, so I'll click More Fonts. Now I can choose any Google font, and if I still don't see Poppins in this list, I can search for it. Now I can select and see Poppins has been added to my dock. I'll click OK, and now I see my font is Poppins, but I want to adjust the weight. In order to change the entire field without adding a span tag, I'll change to the selection tool, and in the text panel, select Medium from my list of weights. Now I'll click on the text box and use the arrow keys to align with the top left corner of my guide text. Then click in the font size field and use arrow keys again to resize. And with it all set, the last thing I want to do is resize the text box. So I'll need to uncheck this link icon so I can change width and height independently. Now I want to create the next text field, and instead of duplicating the first text element, I'll create a new one, which helps keep the CSS styles a little cleaner. I'll key in the text with the line break and change to the selection tool to set my color and font and weight and size. Hit enter now, and I can nudge it into position with the arrow keys. And last, use my arrow keys again to trim the text box size down. Note that by holding the shift key, I can jump 10 pixels at a time. The last thing we need is the CTA. So here's where I'll use the element tool with the div modifier. To make it easier to get the exact size, I'll zoom the stage. You can use the plus and minus buttons or double click to key in a value. So I'll draw a rectangle and double click the layer to name it CTA. Now I'll style it. So in the properties panel, I can assign a background color. And set rounded corners. Notice the link icon is active, so the four corners would be the same. Next, I want to add some text, and I want to nest this inside of the div rather than layer it above. So I'll use the selection tool to double click this div, which moves us inside that element. And you'll see this reflected in the breadcrumbs and layer names. I'll use the text tool to draw a text box and key in Shop Now. Then switch back to the selection tool so I can change the text styles on the entire element in the text panel with color white, center aligned, Poppins font, and medium weight. Now to position this text field, I use the properties panel and this icon to change to percentages, which has several advantages. If I use 10 left and 80 width, this quickly centers the element. The last step is font size, but I can't see my guide now, so to fix that, I'll return to the root div, select the CTA, and set its opacity to 0.5. Now I can see my guide. So double-click the CTA again, and I can finish off the text. The last step is to return to the root div and restore my CTA to full opacity. Here's another advantage of percentages. If I change my button size with the selection tool and enable transform control so I get these resize handles, I see my text stays centered for any size button. I'll restore my stage to 100%, and I think that's everything. I'll toggle my guide visibility to make sure I have all elements in place, and if it looks good, then remove the guide with the delete key. Note that just using the eye icon will not remove an image from a published ad. You'll need to delete the layer from the timeline. A couple things I missed, which are hard to see, are the background color and border. If I click in the gray area outside the stage, I'll deselect everything, and I can set my document page color to pound FA, 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 which is a very light gray. It looks almost white. The other thing is the border, which I want on my top layer so it looks better when I add some animation coming in from off screen. I'll use the tag tool with div modifier again to draw a rectangle and give it a 1 pixel gray border. Some settings you'll probably want to use for all your borders are percentages again, 0, 0, 100, 100. That way, when you resize your ads, the borders update automatically. But there's one problem with this, which we'll fix in the CSS panel. Right now, my width and height are 2 pixels too large due to the border width. So I want to add the style box sizing colon border box to make it behave the expected way. Let's add a little animation. In the CTA layer, right click at a half second and insert keyframe. Since I have the CTA in my end frame position now, I'm going to toggle up and down in both translation X and opacity fields, which sets those as animated properties. And I can confirm that by right clicking the keyframe, animated properties, and I see both will be animated. Now I can click the starting keyframe and shift arrow left a few times, and opacity 0, which gives me a subtle fade in as I scrub the timeline. I can also right-click linear to control easing and select ease out. We're just about done. We just need an exit event, so I'll deselect everything, and in the events panel, click the little plus icon in the corner to create a new event. I'll select document body, mouse, click, Google add, exit add, GWD add, and now on this panel, I'll just add an arbitrary metric ID and the full URL to my landing page. Okay, now I can preview my ad and select the browser I want. I see my animation, and when I click, I'm directed to my landing page. Everything looks good. A couple final things. In the Ad Validator panel, I'll see a real-time view of any problems with my file as I work, and I see all checks are passed. There's also Code View, which allows me to work by hand coding if I prefer, and all those changes will be reflected in Design View. The last step is to publish, and two common choices are Push to Display in Video 360, if you're using that environment, or to publish locally, which is what I'll use. So on this dialog, I normally just accept the defaults, especially Create Zip, and I want to note the location of that zip file because I'll need it when I'm trafficking the ad. I see the success message, and we're done. That completes it. Thanks for watching.